This is Larry Lawton, and he's an ex-jewel thief. Larry's a former career criminal, once considered the biggest jewel thief in the United States.
They have a buffer machine up on the next tier. They put him underneath. They're just talking to him like nothing's going on. And they drop this buffer machine on this dude's head. Okay, everybody, I'm back. We're doing chapter 13 today. We're doing Yazoo and Forest City. That's the two next prisons after Edgefield. I'm going to start them right now. Hope everybody's enjoying it, and stay tuned to the end, and I'll have some updates on what we're doing. Things are going great, and I want to say that. Anyway, I was in Edgefield, and I got transferred. So where am I going? I'm going to Yazoo City, Mississippi. That's a prison in Yazoo City. And it's a new place, and it's a gang unit, I find out. But what happens when you get transferred? You got to do the whole process. You got to go down first from the hole, do the pack up, and you got to get transferred. So when you get transferred, what do you do next? Obviously, the next thing you do at getting transferred is the big thing, is going on Con Air. But first, they get me to Edgefield, and they take me on a bus, and I end up getting to Atlanta, where they're going to pick me up with the plane. So I'm in Atlanta, and I'm saying, oh shit, I'm back in my old freaking crap-ass place I was in. And here I go. What's going to happen? It didn't take me a few hours to find out what happened. We go in, and in the Atlanta holdover, that's a unit where people are just held over, getting transferred for wherever they're going to the next prison. This is not the yard. I was in the yard in Atlanta, but now I'm in the holdover unit. So I go from the holdover unit, and I'm in the holdover, and they put two-man cells. They got five guys in the cell. That's how overcrowded it was. They got five guys in a two-man cell. Oh, man, this is going to be great. I got a towel hanging from my bunk, like, to where the light wouldn't hit my face if I tried to even close my eyes. And guard bangs on the door. Take that towel down. I said, are you worried about a fucking towel? And you got five of us in this little cell? It was unbelievable. You talk about inhumane conditions. It's crazy. Sure enough, what do? They come in, a whole goon squad, lock up. I end up getting cuffed up, and I'm thinking, oh, what are you going to do to me? I'm in the holdover. So what are you going to put me to another cell? Nope. In Atlanta, they take me on an elevator, and they bring me to the hole for the prison. In the prison. I go, they're not even supposed to do that. So they head me up. I'm going to the elevator. They take me, and they put me in a cell. It's cold out. It's 50 degrees outside, but I'm in the cell. They strip me naked, literally naked, and they throw me in a holding cell. And I'm literally curled up in a ball, naked, no blanket, nothing, shivering. I'll never forget it. And I'm just shivering. And I thought, oh, here they go. They're going to fuck with you. They put me in the hole in the prison. Now I'm a holdover inmate. That means I'm not assigned to that prison. I shouldn't have been in that hole. But they did it anyway. And I thought they were going to do some beatings or something on me, but they didn't. They didn't beat me at that point. I end up getting back about 3 or 4 days later. They put me back in the holdover. And again, I'm in a crowded place. I think there was only three inmates in that cell. Out of a two-man cell, but it was three inmates. And here I am. I said, okay, I'm whatever. I'm waiting for the plane. So I'm in the holdover for a few years. And anybody you ever meet who's ever been in the federal system, you'd ask them about the Atlanta holdover. It's just as bad as the prison. It's terrible. One time, guards let out four inmates to mess up another inmate. Now, this is in the holdover unit. And they got him. And I helped the guy with his lawsuit. They stabbed him in his eye and knocked his eye out. So, I mean, this disgusting place that Atlanta is. It probably is that way to this day. So, anyway, do that next process. The bus comes. They pick you up. Cuff, search everywhere. You're going on Con Air. You're doing the whole route again. I'm on Con Air. I go to Oklahoma City. I'm waiting to get transferred because I'm going to Yazoo City, Mississippi. And that's my next prison. So I ended up getting a Yazoo Mississippi, and it's a new unit. It's pretty new, almost brand new. And I find out it's a gang prison. It's a gang unit. Okay, so whatever. It doesn't matter to me. I got a good reputation. I'm a stand-up dude. People who know me know I fight the system and the whole work. So I'm in Yazoo prison, and you know when stuff happens all the time. I'm in Yazoo prison 1 week. And you know, when you've been in the prison system for a while, you know you can pick out tension. You can feel tension. You can feel it in your body. And you know when something's going on. There's little signs. Like if you're looking around, you see a dude who's normally with flip-flops. And he's got his flip-flops on at night, every night. All of a sudden, one night, you see him in boots or sneakers. And you go, what's going on? It's like a telltale sign. You'll see a dude with two shirts on. And you'll wonder what he's got, because one shirt is holding up magazines. They use magazine for body armor when you get stabbed. It's literally like body armor. So the little things you see going on in a prison. And one night, you know something's going on. Everyone's drunk. It was a prison that was going crazy. And I said, oh, something's going down. I could feel it. I know something's going down. Sure enough, the next morning, the doors get cracked at 6 a.m. So the guard comes around. It's not electric doors like you'll see in some movies. It's what they call turnkey, which means you have to, the guard goes to every cell and comes, and you hear him start coming down, and you're ready. You're getting up. Well, this day, now, the prison system has no money. So you're talking about messed up, and they got sued on this, actually, the Federal Bureau of Prisons. You have two units, one here and one here, and in the middle is where the offices are, like I explained in all the earlier videos. So there's unit here, unit here. Well, at nighttime, when all the inmates are locked in, the prison system had one guard that would handle both units. So when the guard walks around at 6 a.m. to open this whole entire unit, he's got to go to the next unit and open up that unit. Well, when he opens this unit up, all the inmates come out of their cells. Everybody. All ready to go. It looked like it was some kind of coliseum. And these two inmates, a black dude and a Hispanic dude, are in the middle of the unit going at it. Now, myself, I'm up against a wall. I met an inmate, Big Ron. To this day, he's a great friend of mine. So Ron, it was huge dude. He's older dude at that time. He's about in his maybe late 50s. And big old dude. I mean big. And him and I really become close friends. We used to walk the track together. Hands were humongous. And we were standing. He was selling a few cells down from me. And he comes up. And we got our backs against the wall. We're watching this whole thing. Now, there's inmates all over the place. These two dudes go at it. And when I say go at it, I mean blood. One guy gets the bat. He starts kicking the other guy. Every time he kicks him in the face, blood is splatting all over. Bam, blood, bam. They end up breaking it up. The two shot callers, the heads of the Hispanic gang and the heads of the black gang, they break it up and they go against. And now the guard walks into the unit. He knows something's going on, but he don't know what's going on. He's a rookie. He's pretty new to the system. So he really didn't know what was going on. And what does he do? Nothing. They call chow. The whole unit goes to the chow. Sure enough, somebody snitched. Somebody did something. After chow, they call lockdown. Lockdown. When they say lockdown like that, they don't know why. They're locking the prison down because they knew that there was a fight between the blacks and the Hispanics. And they don't know if it's the Bloods and Crips against the Bices or the Mexican Mafia or the M.A. or the Sereños, the Aztecas, whoever. They don't know. So they lock the prison down. And there goes that process. When they lock the prison down, everybody's locked in their cell. You get fed in your cell. They're supposed to give you showers. A lot of times they don't. And what do? Every cell gets shaken down. So they'll come and they'll take you out. They'll strip search you and they'll get against the wall. And they got three or four guards go in that cell and they rip your cell apart. And I mean everything. They find everything. They find if you're making wine, they find any little shank you have, little razors we cut with, all of that. It's gone. It's lost. And the guards, if it's bad enough, they throw you in the hole. You'll see them marching people off to the hole. Now, during this process, they also know what they're looking for. They got enough snitches in the system to know Oh, man, I could guarantee that, you know, they say, hey, these two guys went at it. This is what it's over. Somebody owes money. So they start, you could see them pick and choose who they want to really mess with. And they got the people and they gone. Eventually, the whole yard opens up in about a week when they know nothing's going to happen. They'll literally get the inmates together and find out what's going on. Is this going to be a massive riot? You know, in my opinion, I think the prisons want that. They don't care about that. And they rather see inmates fighting each other than thinking about escaping or thinking about any other kind of thing they're going to do. They actually do that. And the brawl, so after that lockdown, you know, another inmate comes into the unit and the two shot callers get, I end up getting inmates in the unit and there's a hit out on them. So what do? The seven guys come into the unit and they fuck this dude up. But the gang of the other dude, now this is white guys now, the gang of the other dudes fight. So now there's about a 7-on-7, 7-10, whatever it is. There's fighting going on all over the place. These guys are fighting. These guys are fighting. You're in the unit. And I'll never forget, I was playing chess. I used to play chess, backgammon, pinochle, gin rummy. And I'm playing with a friend, and we're just playing chess at that time in the morning. I used to play chess. I used to be pretty good, not anymore. Obviously, you know, you don't do that for a while. You can lose some of that. So anyway, they go at it. And here again, it's another lockdown. So we come out of that lockdown, and I got the guys who were fighting. There were two white gangs. I got them together, and I said, what are you guys doing? You know, I'm already got a reputation in the prison system to be a stand-up guy. I used to fight the system. I used to help a lot of people out with legal work. So I had a good reputation. So I told these dudes, I said, what are you fighting for? We're in a prison with 2,000 inmates. And there's about 350 white guys. And this has nothing to do with race. Because people who know me even on here, anywhere, there's no racism in me. There's zero prejudices in me in anything. But here are these guys, I'm saying, what are they doing? Why are you fighting each other when we got 350 white guys on the yard and you're fighting each other? You shouldn't fight other inmates. You want to fight the system. Fight the system for what's going on in the system. That gives me a lot of... I give you a lot of respect when you're fighting the abuses that are going on in the prison system. There's enough of those. You know, there's no rehabilitation in the system, and we're going to talk about more about that. So I'm in this prison thinking, okay, all right, I got it going. I'm there a couple of months. Who pops on the yard? Rick Brawley. Rick Brawley was the... Now, he comes to Yazoo, Mississippi. He was sent by LaManna. He comes to Yazoo, Mississippi as the head of SIS. This dude was my unit manager in Edgefield when I was fucked with so bad that they sent him to Yazoo, Mississippi as the head of SIS to fuck with Larry Lawton. Sure enough, I'm on the yard. Never forget, I was talking with Ron. He'll remember it to this day. And sure enough, I actually said to Brawley, I said, man, just leave me alone, man. I don't want to start trouble. I won't write letters. I won't do it. I just want to do my time. I only got about a year and a half, maybe 2 years left, less than that, on my bed left. I'm going home. I just want to do my time, man. Nope. Throws me in a fucking hole for some bullshit, maybe a gambling ticket or some bullshit. And it was bullshit because I was doing nothing on that yard. I was doing law work. And I said, okay, fuck it. Start writing letters again. I'm writing senators. I'm writing everybody. Brawley tried to break me, is what he tried to do. Because before I go to the hole, I was in Yazoo, and I started watching TV. I didn't bother anybody. I went to the TV room. It was a gang unit, so I was pulling paperwork. And pulling paperwork means, in prisons, they don't let you bring your paperwork with you, meaning your legal work. You, as a person out there, if you're watching this and you get arrested and you go to Federal Bureau of Prison, you can't bring your legal work to the prison with you. And the reason they do that is because they want to protect the snitches and they want to protect the pedophiles, the people who have charges that I used to look up. So if a gang shot caller wants any information from a dude on the street, guy wants to become a gang member, what does he do? How does he do it? Comes to Lawton. He says, hey, lad, he goes, I need you to do me a favor. He goes, here's this dude's number. Here's his social. Here's where he lived. Here's his date of birth. And here's his name. Can you find out about him? It was easy for me to do that. I had a lawyer on the street. I used to send all that information. They could look it up. And you know what they get? Called a docket sheet. So you can get the docket sheet of a guy's case. And in the docket sheet, it says what the case is. Now, there were certain codes you'd have if you were a pedophile. Now, let me give you what I mean by that. If you're a 17-year-old kid or an 18, 19-year-old kid, and you had sex with a 17-year-old girl, we didn't give a shit. We didn't care. Even though it's against the law, that was a crime we'd give a pass to. That we didn't consider you a pedophile or a child molester when you did that shit. Even though you got charged with that, we didn't consider that a charge that you should be fucked up with. Now, there's a charge in the code number, 1800 something or whatever it was, would be if you had sex with a person under 12. If we found that out, you were fucked. You weren't getting away with it. It was some of the worst things that'll ever happen. Matter of fact, what happens in prison, if you're my cellie in prison, and I pull your paperwork, and I find out that you were a child molester, that level, fucking with an under 12-year-old, it's my duty as a convict to fuck you up. So the cellmate of a dude who thought he was cool, he might have gave him soups, hung out with him, didn't know that the dude was either a snitch or a child molester for sure, would fuck that dude up. So we pull paperwork on this fat, dumpy white dude in his 40s. Look like a little, I hate to say the typical look, but I'll never forget this fucking guy's look. He's fucking short and fucking dumpy, fat, and fucking, he just looked like a fucking pedophile. Sure enough, I pull his paperwork. Has the charge, had sex with a girl that was 10. Never forget that, 10 years old. So I bring the paperwork to the dudes. Bunch of the guys got together. We're in a cell. I said, man, this is it, man. Look at it. It's your cell, you motherfucker. It's your job. You're ding. Now, we'll wait a minute, and we give him a guy a day or two to take care of this fucking problem. Sure enough, the fat, dumpy guy's sitting in a TV room. He's looking up at a TV. Yeah, another, you could tell he's not a real convict. He doesn't know. You put your back to the wall if you can or whatever. And he's up. He's sitting in his chair. This dude comes up from behind. Bam! Fucking slams this fucking guy right in the head with a punch. Knocks him down. The dude had steel boots. I'll never forget the boots because he used to always walk around with boots. It wasn't that like you needed to. Sneakers, yeah. Anyway, this guy was a troublemaker. If you want to call him a troublemaker, a dude that always wore boots. You were always ready. And we're all standing there watching this up against the wall. And blood goes flying. Blood's flying. Blood is flying. He's kicking this fucking dude in the head. Guy's fucking out. I mean, literally. I mean, totally out. We all get out of there. We go. There's no cameras in TV rooms. There's no cameras in the TV room. So sure enough, the guy's laying there, pool of blood. We all go, just leave. Sure enough, a guard makes a round. See, so first of all, he saw a lot of people up around that area in the corner where the TV room was. He walked by. Everyone's gone already. Hits the alarms, hits the deuces, the button on their radio. Hits them. And, you know, start screaming, you know, lockdown, lockdown. Everybody's running to their cell. Everybody takes off and they get in their cell. And this guy is dragged out of there, literally on a stretcher, fucked up royally. And that was taken care of. The dude who did it, good dude, got to give him a lot of respect. He did what he had to do in the joint. If you're a child molester, they're worse than rats. And especially, you know, again, child molesters is a funny charge because if you're a 20-year-old kid out there and you have sex with a 17-year-old girl, it's consensual. I'm not talking rape. I'm talking you girls with girlfriend, boyfriend, whatever. Even though that's legally a charge, we didn't consider it one. The convicts, listen, man, that's a pass. You know, that's bullshit. We're not going to fucking hold you accountable for that. It's just not what convicts do. And we didn't do that. And that's it. So here I am. After all this kind of shit goes down, Brawley's on the yard. He probably also, given this, he knew it was Lawton that pulled the paperwork. Lawton had a, you know, reputation to not like snitches and not like child molesters for sure because of my own past. And you know, everybody, if you read the beginning of my whole entire book, I was molested by a priest when I was 11 years old. And I don't ever make that as an excuse of why I turned out fucked up. But a lot of people say it is, and even psychologists I deal with. Just a lot of things happened after that I guess I was acting out. But, you know, I don't make an excuse. My choices were what put me in prison, not those choices. But now here I am in the hole again. I met a great guy. To this day, I know him very well. Ron, he's a big, great friend of mine. To this day, we talk a lot. I love him. He's out of California. He went away he was actually in San Quentin. He's a real convict. Ended up going to the feds because he was a convict with a gun in Montana. You're in Missoula, Montana, and you have a gun. Doesn't everybody have a gun? And being he was a convict, got 10 years in prison. 10 years. I tried to help him with his legal work to try to get him out. Couldn't do it. So here I go. Where am I going next? In the prison system, you're supposed to go to a closest prison. I only got about a year left, maybe less. And you're supposed to go to a prison closer to your home because you're getting discharged out of the prison system. They're supposed to try to help you reintegrate in any little way so you get more connections with your family and visits. What do to me? They send Lawton on a fucking bus again, the whole transfer process, to Forest City, Arkansas. Even farther away from my home in Florida. So are you kidding me? You want to talk about being screwed over? Of course I got screwed over. Prison system. So here I go to Forest City, Arkansas. I get to Forest City. Brand new joint. I was an opening busloads that came in there. Sure enough, it's a great prison. I actually had no Brawley, no LaManna. They kind of left me alone. There was a lieutenant, a lady there, and I don't remember her name. So I did not remember her name, but I remember her, and she was all right. She knew my record, said, listen, Lawton, nobody's going to bother you here. Do your remaining of your time and get out of prison, and you're done. Nobody's going to bother. And I did. I mean, I went to this prison, and I'm like, wow, this prison's not that bad. I'm in Forest City. It's a long way from home, but it's a lot better than the prison I just came from where they screwed me. The prison was, again, it's the Brawley and the fucking people that followed my record. You know, people out there might be saying, oh, you started all this shit, Lord. You could have laid down. I'm not going to lay down when they're killing people. I'm not going to lay down when the Federal Bureau of Prisons is killing people. And they're doing that to this day. Private prisons now are the biggest mistake. But I'm getting off track, which is normal. So here I go to Forest City, Arkansas. And what do? I'm doing legal work. I'm in the library. I got a good reputation. People knew me in the prison system that, hey, Lawton, when you start transferring in the prison system like I was, and because of why, I had a good reputation. I was a convict, known as a convict. And I also helped people a lot. Did a lot of legal work, fought the system, fought rules like the jacking off rule or whatever it is. I fought stuff to help inmates and to help people in the joint. So the prison didn't like me, but the convicts knew who I was. People knew me. So I'm on the yard, and I meet an inmate who's the head of the Aryan Circle. This guy's name was Bruiser. Good dude. Bruiser was the head of the Aryan Circle. He was their shot caller, and he knew I wasn't a gang member, and I'm not a gang member, and I didn't want to be in any gang. But he also knew, hey, Lawton can pull paperwork. So what does he do? Guy passes me a paper. I'll never forget. I was in the chow hall, and a guy passes me a piece of paper, and it's a name, and a guy's where he's from and stuff, and Bruiser's sitting at the table. This Bruiser didn't even hand me the paper. Another one of his guys did, and he says, hey, Lack, can you do me a favor and just pull this guy's paperwork? We want to know. He wants to come join us. I always try to recommend to young people, don't get into that gang shit. There's nothing good about it. You might have to kill somebody who's sitting in your group seat. Think of that. You get a prison for 5 years and you join a gang and you're in there and you got to kill someone because they're in your seat. Think about that. How messed up is that? Anyway, I said to the kid, I said, not to the kid, I said to Bruiser, I said, okay, I'll take care of it. Sure enough, I get the paper back in about 3 weeks. I made a few phone calls, got to the lawyer, pulled the paper. I get the docket sheet. Sure enough, kid was no good. Kid was a snitch. Now, he wanted to join the gang thinking nobody's going to pull his paperwork. He could talk tough. He could be protected. He knows down deep he's the snitch. Doesn't know I'm pulling his shit. And as I say, if I want to find out about you, I could. So I pulled this dude's paperwork. Sure enough, I call Bruiser into my cell. So he comes in with one of his lieutenants. I got him, sit down. I said, look what you got here. This is the guy you want in your plane. He goes, fuck this shit, man. I step back. I don't do anything. I don't care. So I'm in the unit, and I'm talking to someone near the TV room. There are four TVs up on the walls, and I'm just watching one of them. And all of a sudden, I see these two Aryan Circle dudes start talking to this guy. Now, I know what happened to this guy. I know his story, the real story. So what happens? They guide him over, and they're talking to him. I'm looking, and I look up on the second tier. On the second tier, there's two dudes lifting a buffer machine. You know that big buffer machine you see in schools or you see in airports? The guy in the buffer, you know, he's working the machine. They have a buffer machine up on the next tier. They put him underneath. They're just talking to him like nothing's going on. And they drop this buffer machine on this dude's head. I'll never forget. It crushed this guy's side. His whole body went down. It was like he crumbled like a bag of potatoes, just crushed down, and boom, and he was laying limp. He didn't get killed, I know that, but I could tell you he got fucked up. And he was laying, these guys walked away, and I'm like, holy shit, I gotta stop this crap. At that point, I said to myself, I gotta stop pulling paperwork, because I'm gonna get wrapped up in a conspiracy. If they kill the guy, and they find out I'm part of pulling the paperwork, getting the guy, I'm going to prison for life again. I'm going to be involved in a murder conspiracy. And I didn't want that. So I ended up stopping. In fact, the last time before even I had anything going on, I made sure they gave me another guy. And sure enough, I pull him and he was no good. He was a no good. And when I say no good, that means his record was sketchy. He either did a crime that was against something that the standards of that gang, was a snitch or something, or definitely child molester or something like that, or even a gang member didn't like people beating on old ladies or something like that. That's not respected in prison. So anyway, sure enough, this guy was bad. And I'm going, oh, fuck. You know, here I am. Oh, fuck. I kept stalling Bruiser and say, man, I didn't get it back yet. Let us know. And I knew I couldn't do it because I said, this guy's going to get killed. Something's going to happen. And all of a sudden, Larry's going to be in a conspiracy for murder. And because I'm really near the door now. I'm that close to the door. So, I mean, I still had to be a convict. And I'll tell you what I mean by that. I used to watch CMT. CMT is country music. I was never a country music guy until prison. We had a TV room. So every morning, I'd get up at 6 o'clock in the morning. I'd go to the TV room. And I, what they call, hold it down, or it's our TV room anyway, but I would be there and I'd watch CMT. So I'm sitting in there and a black dude walks in, kid had dreads, I'll never forget him, he was a skinny little kid, and he comes up to the TV and he changes the TV. What the fuck are you doing? Change the TV to BET. I used to watch it, but this is our TV, I watch what I want. So you can never be perceived as weak in prison. So this dude actually came up. I'm the only one in the TV room. And he smashes this fucking TV, you know, turns the TV. And I'm like, what? So he looked at me like I wasn't going to do anything. I said, what the fuck? And when he like kind of didn't turn, I grabbed him by his fucking dreads. And face right in the concrete wall. Like I did the dude in the who had the shaving. Boom. And he fucking literally falls out of my hand. Blood's, you know, you break the nose, you break everything. The blood goes freaking down. Boom, he's laying on the floor in a hump. I fucking get out of there. And I go, oh, shit. Here I am. I got 6 months to the door. I'm fucked. I mean, I'm going to get in some trouble. Something's going on. I'm going to try to fucking protect my life, whatever. So I go to Bruiser. Bruiser's the shot caller. I say, Bruiser, I got a problem. He goes, what happened, Matt? And I told him exactly what happened. Boom. He goes and has a sit down with the dude who these guys represented, the black dudes. And sure enough, everything was squashed. Hey, listen, even the Bloods and the Crips, they love me. I used to help them pull paperwork. So when they were pulling people's paperwork, listen, Larry's going to help us, man. Larry's a convict. This is what happened. They ended up even fucking that dude up. That dude ended up getting off the yard, meaning he got thrown to the hole. Because what happens when people, they have what they call a check-in move. Some dudes have a problem on the yard, whether they owe money, whether they think someone found out they're a snitch, or whatever the case. So they do what they call, instead of going up to the guard and saying, hey, listen, I'm in fear for my life, I need to go to the hole. Some do that. That's called checking in. And some go up to the guard and say, fuck you, motherfucker, you're a dick, man, I should kick your ass. Of course, the guard's going to hit the button, this guy's going to go in the hole. And he does that. They call that a check-in move. He wasn't going to do anything to anybody, but they call that a check-in move. And so, I mean, I knew the system. I knew who was good and bad. But these dudes all stuck up for me about this dude because he shouldn't have did what he did. That's disrespecting me. You don't disrespect people like that. You just don't do that, man. Right before I'm ready to leave Forest City, Arkansas, I said, okay, I'm getting close. What happens? I'm sitting playing chess again. A bunch of people come in the unit and a fucking fights break out. They're all around me. I'm at a table. Fight over here, fight over here, fight over here. People are fighting again. I said, holy shit, this gang unit shit is crazy. You know what they were fighting over? Like I said earlier to dudes who want to be in a gang, one dude disrespected another group by sitting in their chair and not fucking listening to the dude when he got out. And a guy didn't do anything in the chow hall because everybody's in the chow hall, the captain, the warden, everybody. You're not going to really get anything done. You know, again, that's something that's a bravo move, but nothing's going to happen. There's too many guards there. There's too many people there. You know, that's just all bullshit. Unless you get killed. When I saw a dude in Atlanta on a chow line, a dude jumped the chow line. Another dude fucking stabbed him. Killed him dead right when I was there. I'm like, man, am I in a way crazy? I was in Atlanta. I think I said that story back in the day. So anyway, here I am. I said, man, am I getting out in the right time? So here it is, literally days before I'm going, and it's February, and I'm getting out in March, and I'm going to a halfway house. So February, it was Super Bowl. Never forget, Super Bowl 2007. And I throw a party in the TV room. Everybody's invited. Black dudes, white dudes, Mexican dudes. All they knew Larry. It was cool, dude. I paid for the food. I bought sodas. I had guys make pizza, which I'm going to do a video on how we used to make food. Made food and pasta, and everybody had food and stuff. I even had a raffle for some stuff. Like, I bought a little player that you could play some shit with. I bought that off the commissary, and I raffled that off. I mean, it was crazy. I just wanted to do that. I loved people, and I done some like shit like that. Everybody, dudes come from other units. Even the guards there were cool and let dudes come into the place. So anyway, right before I'm ready to leave, you give your shit away. And this sounds crazy. When I say give shit away, I'm talking about you give away a sweatshirt. You give away your cup and your bowl, your spoon. You give away the better clothes you had, maybe tailored from the laundromat. Your shorts, the stuff you don't want, you're giving everything away. And it's like a big deal. And you're going to see millionaires ruffling through your shit that you throw on the floor that you don't want as somebody else wants. It's like a big deal. So here it is, the night I give everything away. I'm ready to go. And you want to talk about a feeling elation. It was crazy. We're sitting there, and when I tell you you're having the best time of your life, you're thinking, and the guard says to you, hey, listen, Lawton, pack up. An hour before count time, they do that. An hour before count time, the dude, before letting out, before 6 in the morning, an hour before that happens, they let you out. Sure enough, you want to talk about fun, you want to talk about a feeling, and they tell you to go to R&D. And when you get to R&D, that's going to be video number 2. That's the end of this chapter. Next chapter, I'm going to be talking about getting out. And that's going to be a wild, wild chapter. some really emotions are going to come out and stuff that happened to me. Appreciate all the stuff you're doing. Please check out my merch. You can see this shirt, but we got a new shirt, Cash is King shirt. Check it out. It looks pretty cool. Darian designed that. It was really cool. Keep doing what we're doing. Follow us on Instagram. That's building up. Again, you could read, you could listen to this on the podcast on iTunes and Spotify in the links below. Check that out. The merch is in the links below. Please support us any way you can. We really appreciate we're building this channel. We're building this network, and we want to make change. And all you people are part of it. Thanks a lot, everybody. Really, from the bottom of my heart, make good choices. Don't do what I did. Don't make the bad choices I made. You know, be you. Be who you are. But don't make those bad choices. Think before you act. Thanks, everybody. Much love. Never forget. Have a good one.